To catch the criminally insane, you have to think like them. But once you've entered a mind of madness, can you ever get out? That's the central question in writer and director Michael Mann's 1986 psychological thriller Manhunter, based on author Thomas Harris's novel Red Dragon, the first of an ongoing series of stories that revolved around the serial killer Hannibal Lecter. In this first story of serial killers and the gifted but tortured people who capture them, we follow former FBI criminal profiler Will Graham, played by William Peterson, who is asked to help catch the serial killer known as the Tooth Fairy, and who we will soon come to know as Francis Dolarhyde, played by Tom Noonan. Mann's film revolves around what it takes to both understand and stop a killer by balancing experimentally subjective presentation with fact-based crime procedural, sinking audiences into the slowly unraveling mind of Will Graham as the investigator subsumes himself into the mind of a serial killer. Here, we'll look at Michael Mann's use of expressionist filmmaking to bring his audience in tune with both the investigator and killer's tortured minds, Manhunter's use of implied, almost unspeakable horror, and the film's focus on sight and reflection, which both fuel and destroy inner demons.
Give it up! Forget this month, it's too damn late.
I gave it up. Till you showed up with pictures of two dead families, knowing goddamn well that I'd imagine families 3, 4, 5, and 6, right?
Manhunter is somewhat of an outlier within the larger filmography of Mann, not as much as his World War II supernatural thriller The Keep, but still unique for the director's decision to delve far deeper into horror than most of his films. But its central tortured male protagonist and its driving sense of self-destruction for the sake of a greater goal is classic Michael Mann. Like the rest of Mann's career, Manhunter is propelled by meticulous research and the committed presentation of detailed processes. While writing the script, Mann consulted with the FBI's Behavioral Science Unit and corresponded with murderer Dennis Wayne Wallace, while Peterson and Noonan researched real-life people related to their roles. Here, Mann devotes lengthy scenes to fingerprinting, handwriting analysis, crime scene investigation, and FBI briefings. All the legwork and hard hours that need to be spent to catch a killer. The process isn't romanticized. It's illustrated as being mentally and spiritually taxing, especially for Graham. "What drew me to the story was its connection to the essence of evil," said Mann, "which emerges in the process of dehumanization that leads a simple human being with no exceptional past to become a killer capable of the most terrible atrocities. And when the victims cease being human beings, they become morsels, bits of matter. I want to understand just what this is all about, as well as the influence of social context on the behavior of individuals, such as fascism, genocide." Mann's focus on realistic detail also extends to his killer's methods, but by showing his planning and motivations, but not the killings, Mann strips the serial killer archetype of its mythologizing. We're left with the banality of evil. Mann removes most of the Red Dragon imagery from Harris's novel, excising the mythology, and leaving the pathetic man whose psychosis has led him to believe that murder will bring him closer to greatness. Likewise, Hannibal Lecter becomes a banal killer ruled by a sociopathy, rather than the all-powerful figure of fascination he'd become in later novels and adaptations. It's clear that Lecter's ability to attack people's weaknesses is his greatest strength, but he's still a mentally disturbed individual first and foremost. Graham himself even points it out.
"I thought you might be curious to see if you're smarter than the person I'm looking for."
"Then by implication, you think you're smarter than me since you caught me."
"No. I know that I'm not smarter.
Then how did you catch me,
Will?" "You had disadvantages."
"What disadvantages?"
"You're insane."
Lecter is a piece of the puzzle, a hint at the larger world of psychotic evil that threatens our seemingly peaceful existence. He's not the looming mythic figure in Manhunter. He's the key to Graham understanding a world that he tried to remove himself from, but knows has always been there, threatening the love he's rebuilt with his wife and son. Years before the story began, Graham caught Lecter, but he was not only horribly injured, but committed to a psychiatric institution due to the effects of bringing his mind into concert with a serial killer. The conflict between scientific analysis and unspeakable horror happens within Graham's mind, and this is where Mann's experimentation begins. Cinematographer Dante Spinotti deals in high-contrast colors that wash over the frame in Manhunter's most emotionally charged scenes. Sickly greens often indicate the presence of Dolarhyde's Red Dragon persona, while deep blues connect Graham to his family, these colors have no natural source, unlike much of the rest of the movie, telegraphing their subjective nature to the viewer. In contrast, every FBI interior is blasted out with bright fluorescent whites, creating a sterile, stark look. Lecter's cell is white on white, far removed from the dank, gothic dungeon of Silence of the Lambs. "It bores me to present the events of the story in a realist style," said Mann. "My approach instead is to conceptualize the elements of the plot, taking into consideration the various torments of the human spirit. My aim is to exteriorize the spiritual in the expressionist manner, and this always leads me to reject realism." Mann and Spinotti also highly favor intense close-ups for the film's most introspective moments, staying tightly cropped on Graham or isolating him in the frame, focused on his thought processes and observation rather than what he's actually observing. Mann also cranks up the score by Michel Rubini and the Reds for moments of epiphany, drowning out most other noises as the synth-heavy sounds create a rising tide of emotion. The same goes for its use of pre-existing songs, blasting in Dollarhide's home, or non-diegetically used to convey massive sea changes in feelings. When this is combined with slow pans, fixating dolly movements, and slow motion, the result is a hypnotic trance that works to turn the spellbound inner life of Will Graham, or the painful mental turmoil of Francis Dollarhide, into literal film language. The challenge of Manhunter is to have Graham feel what his target is feeling without ever seeing him, to have audiences mentally process what a fictional character is processing, and to have viewers mentally see what man does not allow us to literally see. Manhunter deals in grisly subject matter, killings and mutilations being the modus operandi, but Mann never shows the acts themselves and rarely shows the bodies. Instead, we're often locked into Graham's perspective, reading case files and visiting blood-spattered crime scenes. We, the audience, experience these horrors alongside the protagonist and process the mystery with him. But the gifted Graham thinks differently than the average audience member, so it's not simply enough that Mann puts us alongside him. We have to go within Will Graham to understand why this case both enraptures and repulses him. And that's where Manhunter's intense focus on the act of seeing comes into play. For a film that shows so little of the murderous acts themselves, everything ties back into perception, both self-perception and the perception of others. Mann and Spinotti start their film with grainy, lo-fi first-person footage of Dollarhide's home invasion, placing us into the perspective of a killer we won't see until the second half of the film. This is the perspective that Graham, and we as the audience along for the ride, will now be forced to take. That limited perspective becomes the engine behind Manhunter's use of implied horror. We never see a murder, only its planning and aftermath. Instead, we have the cold, factual details, which become embedded in the deeply empathetic mind of Graham. Graham's visit to the Leeds house, the latest victims of the Tooth Fairy, and his viewing of their home movies is a tug of war between the coldly procedural and the unspeakably horrifying. Almost the entire scene is done with a single camera position, facing Graham as he faces a blood-stained crime scene. A quick reverse shot shows us the details, but the rest is given through his recorded spoken notes. Mann doesn't need to show us the horrors, because what is already implied weighs heavy on our minds. To consider these details is horrifying, but to act them out and inflict them on a family is unthinkable, unimaginable, inhuman. Perhaps the character most informed by the idea of implied horror is Hannibal Lecter, here played by Brian Cox, all dead-eyed stares and brooding physicality. Unlike other films adapted from Harris's novels, Lecter's cannibalism is actually never mentioned in Manhunter, only that he committed horrific killings. When Graham visits Lecter, the killer becomes a scary individual because of what he's implied to have done, and what harm he tries to bring with any small chance, not because of any actions he commits on screen. We see the man, we consider his actions, and the two become one in our minds. Novels are a mental language. They place the thoughts and emotions of a completely hypothetical character into the minds of readers until they become in sync with one another. Films are a visual language, turning audiences into both passive observer and active participant within a story. We can voyeuristically watch someone's most intimate moments without their knowledge, or their eyes can become our eyes. Dollarhide is a voyeur, secretly using the home movies of his victims to pry into their personal lives. Graham watches these movies too, to see what his target saw. And we as viewers watch both men watching others, each of us never letting the other know how intimately we've seen them. All of this back and forth between the diametrically opposed forces of Graham and Dollarhide highlights the extreme, painful difficulty that Graham has in completely bringing his mind into concert with the man he's hunting. It all leads to Graham finally walking in Dollarhide's shoes and seeing the Leeds family as the killer wanted to see them, superimposing another subjective viewpoint over his own eyes. The Leeds family are a picture of domestic bliss that Graham has found after years of torturous work, and are exactly what Dollarhide's murder spree threatens. To protect what he's found, Graham must completely remove himself from his family, and that self-dispossession is what begins to weigh so heavily on him.
Just you and me now, sport. I'm gonna find you, goddammit.
Sight is what defines Dollarhide's motives, and sight is what finally aligns Graham with his target. In his first appearance in the film, Dollarhide kidnaps tabloid reporter Freddie Lowndes and forces him to look at the families he's killed, asking over and over,
"Do you see? Mrs. Leeds, do you see?
Yes.
Mrs. Jacoby, do you see?"
But when he forces Lowndes to see the aftermath of his killings, we see Lowndes see. We don't see for ourselves. Dollarhide, only shown in full once Graham has completely given his mind over to the case, wants to be seen as something greater than he is, which is why his sudden romance with the blind Reba completely throws his worldview off. He's seen as someone desirable, something like what he wants to be, only bypassing actual sight to be seen on another level, even if Reba is tragically mistaken. Even then, Dollarhide's happiness is short-lived because his psychosis alters his sight, believing Reba to be cheating on him and pushing him to kill again. The subjectivity of Manhunter's cinematography extends to its killer's own perceptions, and it's only when Graham discovers that Dollarhide's motivation is sight, illustrated in how he places shards of mirror in his victim's eyes, that the profiler can crack the case.
Your primary sensory intake that makes your dream live is seeing. Reflections, mirrors, images.
Throughout the film, Graham watches victims' home movies to better understand why they were chosen, without knowing that these same home movies were also watched by Dollarhide. Seeing without seeing. And the revelation that his sight and the killer's sight have become one and the same leads to Graham's final epiphany.
You've seen these films. Haven't you, my man?
Like the killer, Graham is fixated on reflections, speaking to himself in the transparent reflections of windows, seeing himself as both pursuer and target. It makes sense then that Graham's epiphany happens as he stares out the window, seeing himself, the killer, and the larger world beyond it all. Like many of Mann's films, two characters reflect one another at the heart of Manhunter. Graham, the self-destructive moral family man. Dollarhide, the outsider who destroys families. Likewise, Lecter is another reflection of Graham, with Spinotti filming their meeting through jail bars that place them both in cages. When Graham looks in the mirror, he sees a killer. It's only fitting that the film's climax sees the shattering of two reflections. Dollarhide breaking a mirror to kill Reba, and Graham jumping through a window to stop the murder. Having these two reflections finally share the same space is almost too much for reality, as editor Dove Hennig fills the scene with disorienting jump cuts. The psychosis has bled into both filmmaking and reality more than ever in this final showdown. It's only by facing and defeating his metaphorical reflection that Graham can restore himself. And unlike Harris's novel, which ends with fakeouts and another home invasion, Manhunter definitively ends with cathartic familial restoration. We've entered deep into the vortex of madness and come out the other side with lives saved and evil ended. Not everyone is so lucky, but the push and pull between madness and order, light and dark, remains within our minds. We'll be right back. Hello and thank you once again for watching. Manhunter is a film that I've sort of been obsessed with for the last year. I'm a huge Michael Mann fan, and I feel like Manhunter is one of the ones of his that is less discussed than the typical. Last year I did a video on Heat, which is probably his most well-regarded movie. And Manhunter sort of encapsulates everything that Mann is great at, but with a sort of twist to it from adapting Thomas Harris's novel. So I hope that you enjoyed it. I know it's a little out of the ordinary, but maybe not so much when you see the sorts of movies that I tend to cover on the channel. I wanted to give a special thank you to my patrons. I am continually thankful for their support. I have listed them all here. Thank you all for continuing to make videos like this possible. As a thank you, I've put out my first Patreon-exclusive review. It's actually a series of reviews, and in one audio episode, I've reviewed 6 different things. I've reviewed 4 comic books, those being Spider-Man Life Story by Chip Zdarsky, Peter Cannon Thunderbolt by Kieran Gillen, Volume 6 of The Immortal Hulk, We Believe in Bruce Banner, and the first 2 volumes of Chip Zdarsky's Daredevil. I also reviewed 2 movies, 1917 by Sam Mendes and Honey Boy by Alma Harrell and Shia LaBeouf. It was really cool to get my thoughts out in a loose, free-form sort of way. I hope that you enjoy them. And again, this is a thank you for my patrons. If you would like to be a patron, it's only $1 a month. I don't have any tiers. Everything is for anyone that pledges $1 or more. I know times are tough and weird, so if you can't afford it, I totally understand. And if you do, thank you very much. I plan on doing more Patreon exclusives without any changes to the main feed format. I hope that you all stay safe, make smart choices, look out for each other, take care, and I will see you again soon.